While the classic red over tan color combination has become synonymous with the Ferrari brand, some models deserve a color scheme that makes them stand out from the pack. A red sports car will always be iconic. However, the wedgie shape of the Ferrari 308 sometimes deserves a color that will catch the eye of everyone you zoom past. Many cars look stunning in darker colors. However, this yellow over black combination on this 308 GTB mixed with the entrancing sound of the carbureted V8 engine is sure to turn heads everywhere it goes. As you might know if you've seen my previous videos on 308s, there was a bunch of different variations made throughout the year. So they started with the fiberglass bodies, carbureted, then like this one, the steel body, carbureted, and it's a fully steel body, but it has an aluminum hood and trunk. And then they went to the injected for EPA reasons, and then finally the injected quattro valve. And one of the things they did throughout the years, like all of the fiberglass cars were all coupes, they were all GTBs. But when the steel body cars came out, they went to coupes and targa tops, or the GTS. And the targa tops were extremely popular, and they sold way more of the GTS than they did the GTB, which is understandable because, I mean, come on, the whole top-down driving experience in a Ferrari, it's, you know, it's iconic. It's something a lot of people want. Me personally, I've always liked coupes over convertibles, but, you know, and I'm not exactly sure why. Maybe it's a safety thing. I've always liked having a roof over my head. I just don't put the top down on cars that often anyways when I'm driving convertibles, but that's always been my little preference. But one of the nice things about coupes in things like in targa top cars, so there's two real upsides, three technically. So first, they're more rare, which means they're more desirable and valuable now. Second would be the coupes, because of how it's shaped, they give you a little tiny bit more headroom. And for me, it doesn't really matter because I'm not that tall, but if you are taller, then a coupe might fit you a little better, especially if you're like long in the torso versus long legs kind of thing. But the third thing, and the big thing to me, is sometimes those targa tops can squeak. And when you get the squeaky targa top, it just disrupts the beautiful sound of the engine, and it just annoys me to no end. They don't all squeak, but it can happen very easily. So you'll never have that issue with a coupe, and that's one of the things I really appreciate about them. So the thing about 308s is because so many were made, and because they're fairly easy to work on yourself as an owner, a lot of them were customized. And the very last 308 video I did, I kind of went into that because that 308 had a lot of little, you know, features that the owner had changed from original just for himself. And, you know, with 308s, it's one of those kind of entry level Ferraris where it's not a huge deal to do. I definitely wouldn't, you know, customize like a $2 million Lusso, but for a $75,000 308, it's not quite such a big deal. But for this 308, it is one of those that was kept all original, and it still comes with a lot of stuff that it came with when new. So these cars came with, like I mentioned, the spare tire. They also came with a jack kit, a tool kit, a set of books, and a little trouble light, which is really cool. So the little trouble light I like because it's just one of those funky little things you're never gonna use, but it's fun to have. It has the little prancing horse on it. Basically, it has a little magnet on the back and a really long cord. So say something goes wrong and you need to work on your car in the dark, the trouble light will just, it's a magnet, it'll stick there. You run the cord inside, you can plug it in, and then you have some light to work on your car. So that's always really nice. And a lot of this stuff is available on like eBay or online where you can buy a replacement if your car doesn't come with one. Say that's the only thing you're missing is the trouble light, is you can go and find one which is nice, but the one thing you can't find, and the one thing that's nice to have original, is the warranty card. So these cars come with books, a set of books with owner's manuals and stuff like that, but the big one is this warranty card. And the reason it's important is because when the car is new, the selling dealer will take the warranty card and they'll write down the dealership information and the first buyer's information. So, and the serial number of the car and everything. So it gives you all the info on who bought it when it was new, and it's specific to each individual car. So you cannot buy a replacement that could pass as original because they all have specific serial numbers and information on them. Plus, they have a lot of cool stuff, like it'll have the door key number, ignition key number. Now these 308s, they don't have the engine number written down, and that's because back in the day, in the beginning of Ferrari, you would have a matching chassis and engine. So if the chassis was serial number 1234, they would stamp the engine to match 1234. But around early 70s, late 60s, so around the Daytonas, the early Daytonas have matching numbers and the late ones don't. Dinos also, they don't have matching numbers. Doesn't mean they're not the original number, you know, engine for the car. It just, they started making so many more cars that they couldn't take the time to individually stamp each one. So they'd take the chassis, the engine, put them together. They were already stamped and they'd note down what number went with what car kind of thing. So the whole matching number thing, it's only relevant to early cars and not later cars. I've mentioned before, I like 308s because they're the last of the analog Ferraris. And if you've ever had a newer Ferrari with their fancy gauge clusters and had the gauge cluster go bad on you, it's kind of a eye-opening experience, because the first thing it does is all the lights start popping on. So you're driving down the road and all of a sudden check engine light and you're like, uh-oh. And then the ABS failure light, you're like, okay, this is bad. And then the transmission failure light and you're like, is my car about to blow up, or is there something going on here? So that's never fun, and you don't get any of those issues with the 308s. They're very simplistic, but purpose-built, and I mean, they function how they should. You get everything you get out of the new electronic gauges without all the electronic gremlins that come with it. And speaking of simplistic, I love the layout of the 308 because it's very kind of user-friendly and instinctual. You get in the car and within a few minutes you kind of figure out where everything is. So like both the passenger and the driver window buttons are right here. The clock is kind of hidden up under the armrest here a little bit, and so is the oil gauge. But when you're driving, you can still see them without an issue. So it's not, you know, it's not in like a super wonky spot. It's just once you see it there and you know it there, you know it's there, then you're all good. And then the center console is nice and simplistic too. You have your AC, you have the little cigarette lighter, which is where the trouble light plugs into and why it has such a long cord. You got your fan, your little antenna button, all the basic stuff is just kind of right here. And it's funny because when you get in a new car with the giant display screen and it does everything from connect you to Wi-Fi to massage seats to, you know, heated or cooled cup holders. I mean, it's luxurious and nice, but it's just something to get in and drive, like get you from A to B in comfort. Whereas this is an experience. It's just a completely different feeling. You're engaged with the car and there's just nothing like it. And another little fun fact. So on the gauge cluster on the right side, there's a little red light with a G on it. That's for the generator. So when you first turn on your 308, the little G will pop up, and basically what you have to do is give it a little rev, like nothing crazy, 2000 RPM or so, and the light will go off, and that basically excites the generator and like gets it to kick on. And if you don't do that and you turn on and off your car a couple times without driving it, then the battery will drain and die because the generator never kicked on. So that's just a little thing to keep in mind, a little fun fact. It's funny because new cars, because they basically drive you, it gives people like a feeling that they're a better driver than they are sometimes. Not saying everyone's a bad driver, just when a car does everything for you, you feel like you're on top of the world. And that's not a bad feeling, but when you're accustomed to new cars like that, and then you get into a car like this one where you actually have to drive it, you know, and it has its own personality and it's gonna talk back once in a while, it gives you that realization that, you know, maybe you're a good driver, but not quite as good as you thought you were. Which, you know, I like the challenge of an old car. And plus, there's something about driving a manual where you can't be sitting there drinking your latte, listening to, you know, talking on the phone over the Bluetooth speaker with the AC on and the cooled seats and the fan and the headrest and all that stuff, which is nice. I mean, trust me, that's great. But you're not experiencing the fun of driving. You're just getting somewhere in comfort, you know, and that's not a bad thing. Again, like, my daily driver is a Tahoe because I can load all my dogs into it and get where I need to go and, you know, all that. But if you want to enjoy the drive, there's something about these older cars that you just don't get with new cars or with automatics in general, in my opinion. And recently, especially, there's been such a craze for manual cars. And part of it, I think, is exactly what I'm talking about. People like the feeling of being in control of driving the car. But part of it, I think, also, like, for instance, when the 355 first came out with the F1 gearbox, it was so clunky and lurchy. And once you got used to it, it wasn't the worst thing in the world, but it definitely was not comfortable. Whereas if you get good with driving a manual, it's smooth and seamless and a lot more fun than just shifting through some paddles, you know, or driving an automatic. So that just gives it a whole new kind of feel to it that you just don't get with new cars, you know? So it's something I will never get over, and it's something I love. You know, that's one of the big things about these cars, that and the history that goes with them. That's what attracts me to older cars.
I've already mentioned that they're the last of the analog Ferraris, so you don't have those electronic gremlins, but they're also pre-sticky switch cars. And if you've seen my videos on some of the newer cars, sticky switches are like my big nemesis. I hate sticky switches so much because the stuff, basically all the plastic bits on the interior of newer cars is coated in this kind of like soft touch material, this like satin feel material that ends up getting sticky with age and if it sits in the sun, and just over time it always happens eventually. So, and it's everywhere. I mean, it's not just a couple little buttons, like it's on the steering wheel shroud, it's on the air vents, it's on the door latches, the seat latches, it's everywhere. You get it on your hands, you get it on your clothes, you get it on the interior of the car, and it's hell. So these cars do not have that issue. You never have to worry about sticky switches, which is just one more little bonus point in my book. And then the color of this car, I love 308s as a GTB in lighter colors, like blue or yellow, like this one. And I mean, I love blue on pretty much anything, so I don't think that counts, but yellow on this car I think looks so nice, because with the Targa, the GTS version of these, it has the black Targa top, and on lighter colors, even on red, it kind of cuts the line of the car and it just doesn't have that same kind of like swoopy fluid line to it. So black really blends in the Targa tops well, but the GTB version in light colors like this is always a bonus point in my book, a plus. And they made less GTBs, so they're more desirable, but when you find them with the light color and in a B, it's just the ultimate in my opinion. a lot of people want your iconic kind of, you know, red tan Ferrari, which I don't have a problem with, especially, you know, the whole Magnum PI feel with the 308s. I completely get it. But over about 45% of Ferraris were red of some variation, whether it's your classic Rosa Corsa or some other variation of red. So having them in another color really kind of stands out from the crowd. And this yellow paint, it is older, it presents really nicely. It does have some crazing in the lacquer. So basically, it's not cracking. It's called crazing because the lacquer will dry over time and create kind of like almost spiderwebby looking cracks, which it's a nice patina actually, because you can't see it from like more than 3 feet away. But when you look up close, it kind of shows the originality and just the history of the car. And it's funny because the word patina gets a bit overused. Sometimes they'll say patina for just like a rust bucket. But in this situation, when you're talking about little tiny things like, you know, original paint crazing and stuff like that, I think that's the perfect way to use the word patina. So I hope you guys have enjoyed this video. If you did, please subscribe and stay tuned, because we got a lot more coming very soon.